successful program aimed at stopping kids from skipping school has won a presidential seal of approval. President Clinton paid tribute to the efforts in Monrovia during his visit yesterday.
Monrovia is a model for fighting crime. That's what the president told a packed auditorium at Monrovia High School.
The day began with honors for the city of Monrovia and ended tonight in Century City.
Monrovia, California. Population, about 38,000.
Day of remembrance, I would ask that we have our beginning our invocation with a moment of silence to remember those who lost their lives on TWA Flight 800. Let us pray. Almighty God, we gather here today to rejoice in the many ways you have blessed our city. We give you thanks for the inspiration and dedication you have given to our leadership, and for the national and international recognition we have received. We ask that as we celebrate these blessings, we not be filled with boastful pride, but rather with a greater desire to do even better in the future. We pray for the President of the United States and all those in authority that you might give them wisdom and a peace that passes all understanding. We pray for protection and care for those who are in law enforcement. Encourage them in their daily rounds. We give thanks for the educators in our communities who have dedicated their lives to imparting the wonders of your creation to future generations. And Lord, we ask your blessing on the children of America, our greatest resource, the reason that brought us here today. Bless them, their families, and our neighborhoods with love and peace. May this gathering today inspire each of us to live closer to you and your will for our lives. These things we pray in the name of our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. Amen.
I'm awestruck. All you good-looking Monrovians and San Gabriel Valleyites, all right. I'm going to read a couple of things to you, and then I'm going to talk from the heart for a few seconds. And I'm going to close with something called the station. I want the president to hear that. Mr. President, on behalf of my Monrovia family, my friends from the San Gabriel Valley, we welcome you to Monrovia, one of America's 1995 All-America City winners. To the best of my knowledge, you're the first sitting president to visit our little hamlet in the San Gabriel Valley. And we're excited that you're here and that we've been noticed nationally for our collaborative partnership method of doing business and solving problems. Monrovia received the All-America City recognition because of a partnership that was developed between our city staff, police department, Chamber of Commerce in our schools, our community to identify and solve community problems. A partnership that expands participation in decision making and is responsible for Monrovia's economic revival and revitalization of our business district, improved housing for our residents, and creation of over 1,000 units of affordable housing. Creation of over 6,500 new jobs. Organizing and developing the largest family festival in the state. Building a new Boys and Girls Club and developing a leadership academy. Building a leadership academy for future leaders. And kind of culminating with the Public Employee Roundtable recognition of our community activist policing program as the best in the nation. And there is much, much more, but I don't have enough time to tell it all to you. We hope you enjoy your visit, and we thank you for choosing Monrovia to spend your valuable time. But before I introduce that, I want the next speaker, I want to read something, Mr. President, that I love. I've read it a few times to Monrovians, and I want to read it to you, Mr. President, because I think it tells a little bit about our city and about the way we approach things. Now imagine, if you will, with me, that you're on a train ride. Let's call the station. Tucked away in our subconscious is an idyllic vision. We see ourselves on a long trip that spans the continent. We are traveling by train. Out the window, we drink in the passing scene of cars on nearby highways, of children waving at a crossing, of cattle grazing on a distant hillside, of smoke pouring from a power plant, on row upon row of corn and wheat, and of flatlands and of valleys, of mountains and rolling hillsides, of city skylines and village halls. But uppermost in our minds is the final destination. Bands will be playing and flags will be waving. Once we get there, all our dreams will come true and the pieces of our lives will fit together like a jigsaw puzzle. How restlessly we pace the aisles, damning the minutes for loitering, waiting, waiting, waiting for the station. When we reach the station, that will be it, we cry. When I'm 18, that will be it. When I buy a new 450 SL Mercedes-Benz, that will be it. When I put the last kid through college, that'll be it. When I paid off the mortgage, that will be it. When I get a promotion, that'll be it. When I reach the age of retirement, I shall be happily ever after. But sooner or later, we must realize there is no station, no one place to arrive once and for all. The true joy of life is the trip. The station is only a dream that constantly outdistances us. Relish the moment is a good motto, especially when coupled with Psalm 118:24. This is the day which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. It isn't the burdens of today that drive men mad. It is the regrets over yesterday and the fear of tomorrow. Regret, fear, disease, the problems of today. So stop facing the aisles and counting the miles. Instead, climb more mountains. Eat more ice cream. Go barefoot more often. Swim more rivers. Watch more sunsets. Laugh more, cry less, love more, hate less, speak softly more often and less accurate. Life must be lived as we go along. The station will come soon enough.
And now may I introduce you.
Mr. President, Lieutenant Governor Gray Davis, Assemblyman Joe Baca, Assemblyman Martin Gallegos, Mayor Bob Bartlett, Monrovia City Council, and ladies and gentlemen, On behalf of the students, staff, and community of Monrovia, it is my privilege to welcome you to Monrovia High School. July 22, 1996 will be a day long remembered in the history of our school.
Good afternoon. I'm Louise Taylor, Superintendent of Schools in Monrovia. President Clinton, it is my pleasure to add my word of welcome on behalf of our Monrovia family of schools and on behalf of our All-America City. My words are spoken with one voice, but they come from many. They come from the Board of Education, our President Bruce Carter, and our members, Francie Cash, Marty Faith, Yoli Gallardo, and Roger Graziani. They come from our dedicated school staff, our parents, and our students. They come from our partners in the city, Mayor Bob Bartlett, City Council members Mary Wilcox, Laura Blakely, Phyllis McCarville, Tom Adams, and City Manager Don Hopper. They come from our community business partners, represented today by the Executive Director of the Chamber, Dick Singer, and President Laurie Herzig. They come from all of us in Monrovia, all of us in this determined, involved, thriving, all-America community.
Well, let me tell you, I can't remember a day in my life where I've been so excited, except at the birth of my granddaughter. I'd like to welcome the president to our city. Thank you, sir, for coming. We're honored. And ladies and gentlemen, the many people out in the audience who are our visitors here today, thank you for coming and helping us celebrate this wonderful day. You know, we talk about partnership. I think every person that's been at this podium has talked about partnership. And I think it's important to note what that means, because it doesn't come easily. It's hard work. Partnership means breaking down barriers between people. It means breaking down bureaucratic barriers. Things that sound like, Chief, don't tell me what to do and I won't tell you what to do. Things like, I've already got enough work to do, don't give me any more work to do. God, we've heard all of those things, especially if we're in government. But when we talk about community policing in Monrovia, that is exactly what we're talking about, because it is absolutely essential to the success of the program that we not only have a partnership, but that we are able to break down those barriers that impede us from our mission and from our goal, and that of protecting all of our citizens in our community. And it starts at the top, ladies and gentlemen. It starts with our mayor setting the tone, our city council over here giving us the support, the school district, the department heads throughout city government that say, we're in this together, this concept of community policing, and we're going to work very hard at it to make it successful. And it works with the liaison with our community that gets them to trust us and understand us and work with us. And not only addressing crime, but addressing the symptoms that breed crime. Things like lousy neighborhoods, lousy living conditions, drug sales, gang activity, children who have no hope, all of those types of things. So I'm very proud of our community policing program, because we've had some remarkable success. And when I say we, I mean everybody in our Monrovia family. Since we started the program in 1990 through 1995, we've had a 31% reduction in serious crime. And for the first 6 months of this year, there's been another 16% reduction in that same serious crime. But when we say numbers, that doesn't mean very much. Percentage points, it doesn't mean very much. But let me give you the hard numbers. That means from 1990 to 1995, 3,000 Monrovians weren't the victims of robberies, homicides, burglaries, aggravated assault. And that means every year thereafter, cumulative, 1,400 Monrovians will not be the victims of those crimes. And it happened because this community is working together with government and with the police department to do the very best that we can. We meet regularly. At some of our meetings, there are 30 participants, and we brainstorm ideas. How do we solve problems? How do we get a neighborhood cleaned up? What is the root cause of the problem? Not just the symptom, the guy standing on the corner selling rock cocaine. We want to know what's the root cause, what makes that person appear there. And we meet and we think about it. And we have ideas about different programs that come up to help us, like our chaplain program, where we put police chaplains who are ministers in our community, in our police car, in a uniform, out in the field, responding to calls for service, dealing with crisis intervention, conflict resolution, helping the needy and the homeless. We come today with our truancy program. That truancy program isn't any wonderful idea of mine, let me tell you. That's the idea of Officer Bill Couch, one of our DARE officers who's standing right over there. He works every day in our classroom providing DARE. And he had an idea that if we can keep our children in school, where they can be educated, where they can get all the tools they need to be successful in life and not out on the streets being truant, where they're experimenting with gangs, drugs, and violence and crime, then they're going to have the opportunity to be everything that they can be. And that was his idea. And let me tell you, it's working. Because Louise told you about a statistic, a 42% reduction in the student dropout, in the student truancy rate. But there's also been, and this truancy ordinance has contributed to it, a 54% reduction in the student dropout rate. And you know why that's so important? Because we know that truancy is habit forming. That the child goes to school, decides that he doesn't want to be there, jumps out for a day, nothing happens. And then 2 days, and then 5 days, and then 10 days, or ultimately the student's failing and not able to even pass. And because of that, they drop out completely. So we're talking about a program, a truancy program, where it's not oppressive to our students. It's meant to let them be everything that they can. And it's simply our way of tapping them on the shoulder and getting them back into school where they can achieve that. And it doesn't come easily. It's a lot of hard work of our officers, of our school officials working together that make it happen. I think when we talk about this program, it's just one of many programs in our community policing program. But it's something that's pointed toward our children, the youth of our community. And Mr. President, I was watching the Olympics the other night, and I was watching you, sir, specifically, when they were playing. When they were playing excerpts from Dr. Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech. Sir, I noticed the tear in your eye when Dr. Martin Luther King talked about the future of our children. That tear, sir, spoke more of your concern and compassion for our children than any number of words could ever do. Thank you. Having said that, sir, I'd like to introduce you to my granddaughter, Jennifer. She's sitting right down there in front. And I brought her here today for two very good reasons. Number one, I wanted her to share this wonderful day and never forget it. But more importantly, sir, I wanted her to see your commitment as the president of our country to her future and the future of American children. Sir, I wanted her to hear your dream, a dream that will give her and every child the opportunity to be successful by staying in school, a dream that will keep them away from drugs and gangs and violence by paying attention to their health, to their nutrition, by paying attention and helping them out of poverty, despair, and hopelessness. Sir, I can tell by that tear in your eye that you believe, as I do, that we are engaged in a mighty battle, a battle for the very safety, future success, or failure of our children. A battle that is taking place in Monrovia and every single city across our nation. A battle that we cannot afford to lose, because our most prized possession is at stake here, that of our children. So, sir, with that, I welcome you to our town. We are very honored. On behalf of all of the members of our community policing committee, thank you for being here. On behalf of our officers who are here today in this auditorium, and the great majority of which who are out in the field participating in this event and who work every day for the citizens of this town, thank you, sir, for being here and honoring us.
Good afternoon. My name is Yolanda Gallardo. In 1990, some of my neighbors came and told me of the concern they had for the safety of their families. Gangs, drugs, and prostitution were happening on the end of their street. I expressed the same concerns because the same things were happening on my end. I contacted the Monrovia Police Department and I asked for their assistance. Our street was accepted into the Community Activist Policing Program. We were fighting not only to take back our neighborhood, most importantly, we were fighting for the lives and the future of our children. As we worked to take back our neighborhood, the city, schools, local businesses, and residents, we're working together to establish the Boys and Girls Club of Monrovia. I was asked to join this wonderful organization, and I am truly honored to be a member of its board. The Boys and Girls Club provides a safe place for the children to hang out, to take cooking classes, childcare, sports, to learn social skills and computer classes, just to name a few of the programs that the youth of our community and surrounding areas may use to help them attain their goals. As parents with students in Monrovia schools, we want to do everything we can to help create a safe learning environment for all students. At both middle schools, Parents Walk on Campus is a new program. Our intent is to help the school staff monitor their campuses both inside and outside. The students feel safer with the high visibility of parents on campus. We have four children, and they weren't very happy with us when we told them that my husband and I supported uniforms in the schools. The uniform policy was adopted by all elementary and both middle schools in the spring of 1995. 95% of all parents participated in the uniform voting, with 85% voting in favor. As I watched the students walking to school, I noticed you could tell that they walked with pride, their heads held high, smiling to their fellow classmates, and smoothing out their uniforms. The uniforms have helped students to focus on classroom assignments rather than on who's wearing designer clothes, who looked good, and who didn't. Uniforms have also helped us with some of our safety concerns. Students not in uniform can easily and readily be seen. This allows school staff to immediately determine whether or not those students belong on their campus. The city of Monrovia has made the youth in our community a priority. We have all heard several times over the phrase, the children are our future. These words are not spoken lightly by Monrovians. These words are felt deeply in our hearts and have led us to take action. It is the responsibility of all of us, young and old alike, parent or not, to do whatever it takes to ensure that our youth reach their goals and that their dreams of success can come true. Our youth truly are the future of Monrovia, the state of California, our nation, and the world. Thank you very much. Honor and a great privilege to be here today, and it is even more of an honor to present to you the President of the United States, Mr. Bill Clinton.
I've worked very hard on the economy and on the security issues, but I've also, perhaps because I was governor of a small state for 12 years, worked very hard to put the federal government on the side of people and communities who are struggling to make the most of their own lives and meet their challenges and protect their values and protect their children. We have proposed to help and support communities that wanted to do a number of things that we thought would improve children's lives. And Monrovia is a sterling example of three of our major initiatives: the community policing, along with citizen participation, a tough truancy policy, and, of course, the school uniform policy. And I wanted to thank you for that. But if you lived in a community where your number one worry was whether your children were safe, whether they were in school, whether your community was functioning, then it would still leave a hole in your heart. You would say, I hear that, but why am I not happy? Because we know that big statistics don't matter in individual lives unless good things are happening in individual lives, in families, on blocks, in communities. And that's where you come in. I hope by coming here today that we will put a face on the idea that the American people do not have to tolerate unacceptable rates of crime. The American people do not have to tolerate worrying whether their children are safe. The American people do not have to tolerate schools that are dysfunctional. If they will get a hold of their communities and work with their schools and work with their police departments, we can turn this country around and we can take this country into the 21st century with the American dream alive for everybody, with a country that's coming together, not drifting apart. And you are the example of what every community can do if they will. I was delighted to hear your chief talk about the statistics you've achieved with community policing. When I became president after the 1992 election, I had already actually been to Los Angeles County in 1990, I believe it was, or 91, to look at a community policing experiment. I'd seen them working all over the country. And the most important thing to me was that they proved that people didn't have to put up with unacceptable crime rates, but that the police could not do it alone. The police had to go back to the streets, but the people who lived on the streets had to come back to the police. And they had to work together hand in hand. So when I asked the Congress to adopt a new crime bill, the most highly publicized parts of it, and they were important, were first passing the Brady Bill and second passing the ban on assault weapons. But let me say that on this anti-truancy program, this may seem simple to you, and I was, where's the officer chief you gave credit to? He didn't stand up. Where is he? Stand up. Where'd he go? You over there? Thank you. Give him another hand. Now, you might ask yourself why other people don't do this. The answer is it probably hasn't occurred to them, and they may not think they can do it. You have proven that it can be done, and you can get results. In the school uniform policy, I understand that that's, when you said it was unpopular with your kids the first time you mentioned it, I can go to any place in America and speak to young people and have them cheering and stomping until I mention school uniforms. And then they go, yeah. But, you know, you may know this, but I went to Long Beach a few weeks ago, and I had two students stand up and talk about it. And one of the young people said, we got to pick our uniforms, and we picked green and white because the gangs were heavy in our area, and they wore red and blue. And it's the first time in 3 years I've been able to walk to and from school without looking over my shoulder. That's worth something. And then one of the things that was said here about it, a young woman said, when she said, it's wonderful now, but it's as good for the wealthy kids as it is for the poor kids, because now we judge ourselves by what we are on the inside, not what we have on the outside. These are good values to get across to our young people. So I just want to encourage you in this. Not very long ago, I was in New Orleans talking about their curfew policy. New Orleans used to have one of the highest crime rates in the country, and they had all these kids on the street at night. So they started a curfew policy, as a number of other cities have, that was very rigorous, but they also set up a curfew center manned by ministers and by psychologists and by healthcare professionals. And I was so moved when I heard the story of one seven-year-old boy that was picked up wandering the streets at midnight, and they took him to the curfew center, and the lady who was working that night said, what do you want? And he said, I want somebody to hold me. Now, if that boy had been found 8 years later, he might have been booked into jail for a felony. Maybe he won't be now because he found somebody to hold him. We have got to take responsibility for the fabric of our children's lives in this community. One of you kindly mentioned the concept village that my wife put in her book. We are responsible for all these kids. One of the reasons this juvenile crime rate's still going up is there are too many of these children out here virtually raising themselves on the street. And they don't know how to do it. It's hard for parents if you do know how to do it. They don't know how to do it. People get into gangs partly because everybody wants to be part of something that's bigger than they are. We all do. When you let kids wear school uniforms, you're putting them in a good gang. The police wear uniforms, they're in a good gang. That's what it is. You identify yourself with something that's bigger than you are. That's what it is. And if you look at the real challenges facing America, the fundamentally critical ones are those that will have to be dealt with one-on-one, child by child, family by family, school by school, neighborhood by neighborhood. And my job is to try to highlight these things and to see that we in Washington do what we can to support you and give you the tools you need to succeed. But if every community in America tomorrow would decide to organize themselves the way you have and to do what you have done, the differences would be breathtaking within a matter of 2 years. That is what I am hoping and praying for, because I'm telling you, there is no country in the world as well positioned as the United States for the 21st century. We understand what it means to be in a global village. We understand what it means to be in an era dominated by information and technology where education is at a premium. And unlike most other countries, everybody from every place else in the world is already here anyway. which is an enormous asset for us. I wish you could have been with Hillary and me the other day when we went to visit the Olympic team in Atlanta. We had them all in an auditorium like this, and we had a lot of the senior Olympians that came back who were the heroes of these present-day Olympians when they were little kids. And we had a great time. But I looked out at them, and it just occurred to me, I said, you know, if they were all separated, just walking around in the village, you might think the Americans were part of one of the Asian teams, one of the Middle Eastern teams, one of the Latin American teams, one of the Nordic teams, one of the European teams, one of the African teams, because we're from everywhere. We're bound together by the ideals and the values enshrined in the Constitution and the Bill of Rights and the Declaration of Independence, and by a sense of mutual respect and the ability to work together. And that's the last point I want to make. Every single thing we have celebrated here today is rooted in the willingness of people here to work in partnership. Almost, I'll bet you, in all these projects you've talked about, when you're enforcing the truancy laws or implementing a school uniform policy or walking the neighborhood blocks, doesn't matter if you're a Republican or a Democrat or an independent. Doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter what your race is. Doesn't matter what your religion is. Doesn't much matter what your income is. Nobody can hide from these things today. We're all in this together. And I see you out here sitting together, applauding your local leaders, applauding what you have done together. And all I can say to you is, please, 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 number one, keep it up. Find ways to increase it. And number two, find ways to talk to your friends and neighbors around the state and around the country about this, because what you are doing will determine whether we can go raring into the 21st century, united and strong. Thank you, and God bless you.
If tomorrow all the things were gone, worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife, I thank my lucky stars to be living here today. 'Cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that fight to me. And I gladly stand up next to you when they make her still today. Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston, and New York to LA, where there's pride in every American heart.